Episode 1937, My Strength is My Story with Paula Faris, Called Out.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo. Staring at a
stop sign, watching people. Happy, happy day. Today is my favorite day of the week. It is my Strength is My Story series, and we have with us an award-winning journalist, Paula Faris. I am so delighted to have her a part of the Create Your Now family. I know you're going to fall in love with her. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends and family of Paula's, welcome to our family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already had the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple Strategy, Everyday Solutions to Live, Love, and Impact. Well, this episode is brought to you by the AIM Academy. Well, have you ever wondered if you missed out on your true calling? Like, really, what are you doing with your life? Where is your worth wrapped up in? You see, Paula Faris had a shakedown, and she shares and writes about her personal story. It's a beautiful story, one where many lessons were learned. You know, some of us think that being a journalist is all glitz and glamour, but Paula may surprise you. She has an incredible warm heart and a personality that draws you in. Open your mind today to hear her heart, because within her story, you just might find your true calling. Without further ado, let's welcome in Paula Faris, Called Out. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I am so excited. We have an Emmy Award-winning journalist with us. I better watch my words. Paula Faris is a wife of 20 years to her college sweetheart, John, and mom to their three children, ages 12, 10, and 6. Paula is an Emmy Award-winning journalist, previously co-anchoring the Good Morning America Weekend Edition, as well as co-host of The View. Paula currently is a senior national correspondent at ABC News and host of the popular podcast Journeys of Faith with Paula Faris. And now to add to her beautiful resume, not only is she a journalist and podcaster, she's the author of her brand new book, Called Out, Why I Traded Two Dream Jobs for a Life of True Calling. Well, get ready, my friend, be called out. Welcome, my sister in Christ. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you so much for having me on the podcast today, Christiane.
Well, we are thrilled to have you here. And oh my goodness, your book is jam-packed with holy richness. Just the whole idea of true calling. I can't wait to dive in. But before we do, I have to ask you, at a time like this, I ask this question to every guest. What brings you joy?
What's bringing me joy right now? The things that don't change in my life, my relationship with God. I know that we aren't promised a pain-free, painless life, but we know that the good guy wins at the end of it. We know that we can take heart. That's bringing me joy. Mascara is bringing me joy. My kids are bringing me joy probably like 49% of the time. Taking long walks with my husband, that's bringing me joy as well. And buttered popcorn is bringing me joy.
I love the buttered popcorn. Buttered popcorn keeps everybody sane, right?
It does.
Well, a lot of people don't get to know the people that they watch on TV. Give us a glimpse into what it was like growing up.
Growing up, I grew up in a small town in Michigan. So I'm a Midwest kid. Raised, my mother and father were both believers. I'm the youngest of four. And I decided to go to a small Christian college in Ohio and then subsequently started working in Ohio after college. So spent 12 years in Ohio and then 6 years in Chicago. And I've been in New York 9 years with my husband and kids.
Mm-hmm. What a journey. Well, where did God meet you in that journey?
I mean, God was with me in the journey. So I feel like somebody said to me the other day that they related to me because I take risks that don't make much sense. I make moves that don't make much sense to people. And I feel like along the way, God has continually asked me to do things. He's asked me to obey. He's asked me to do things that I didn't understand, to make moves, our family to make moves that maybe didn't make sense to the world, but made sense to us. And so I feel like God's been, you know, through the journey, even though there are ups and downs, lots of ups and downs, highs and lows. I know that God has been with me right by my side through it all.
Oh, praise the Lord. He is so good all the time.
Amen. Amen.
Well, how did you find your way into broadcasting?
So I didn't grow up thinking I was going to be a broadcaster. You know, some people see Peter Jennings or Dan Rather or, you know, Connie Chung, Diane Sawyer, like that's what I want to be when I grow up. My nickname growing up was Paula 20 Questions. So I've been inherently curious my entire life. I don't take no for an answer. I'm dogged in my approach, so a little pesky. And it was my high school drama teacher, Mr. Barsoon, who really kind of noticed what some of my predispositions and innate curiosities were. And he's the one that suggested that I go into broadcasting. And honestly, that was the first time I'd thought about it. It was when I was a junior in high school. And he said, you should really think about broadcasting. And so I did. And that's the reason I went into broadcasting.
Wow. Well, I can imagine you have three children. I have five children. We're almost to a football team, which I know you're a Wolverines fan.
Yes.
I don't have a blue sweatshirt to hold up for you.
That's all right. No worries. No judgment here.
Oh, good, good, good. But, you know, in that being moms, what is it like? You know, because we start asking our kids at a very young age, what do you want to be when you grow up? You know, that has a lot of weight. How do you handle that with your children?
Well, I used to ask them that question until, you know, I mention it in the book. You know, after I went through what I went through of, you know, I felt like God called me away from these dream jobs and into a space where I had to figure out who I was outside of what I did. I realized that, you know, we're doing what society tells us, you know, to lean in hard, that our worth is work and our value is vocation, our calling's career, you know, what's your name? What do you do for a living? And then Christiane, the questions that we ask our kids, what do you want to be? What do you want to do when you grow up? As if telling our children very clearly and explicitly that their only value to society is what they do, not who they are as human beings, not the things that are unchangeable and unrootable, especially in a time of crisis. I stopped asking my kids that. What do you want to do and what do you want to be? I ask them instead, I say, who do you want to be? What kind of person do you want to be? Because that really gets into the heart of who you are and why you're here on this earth.
Oh, so good, so good. Well, as you were climbing up your ladder, becoming a rising star, what did you love most about your vocation?
What I loved most about my vocation, you know, I started in a small market. I started behind the scenes, and then my first on-air gig was in Dayton, Ohio, and then Cincinnati, Ohio, and then Chicago, and now New York at the network. What I love about broadcasting and what I always have is that I joke that you have to be a little crazy to want to work in this field because of the deadlines, the unmovable deadlines. You have to be ready to go when that light comes on. And if you don't, that's on you. You look like an idiot. So I think like for me, I get this adrenaline rush from it. I'm on my toes. I feel like I'm my brain's firing on all cylinders. I just feel very like really acutely aware of everything that's around me. So I like that rush of energy and I like the deadlines. Being live, I will say being live is both scary, it's terrifying, but it's also invigorating. And those two aren't mutually exclusive.
Right. It's that paradox, right?
It's a total paradox.
I love it.
Completely.
Well, as you were rising up to bigger and better places, heading to New York, what was sacrificed personally for you?
There are a lot of sacrifices involved moving away from our friends and family. You know, we moved, my husband and I, when we got married, we lived in Columbus, and then we moved to Dayton, Ohio, and then we moved to Cincinnati, Ohio, and then we moved to Chicago, and then we moved to New York. So you think about all of those moves, especially the move to New York was the toughest because our family and our friends and our whole life and our whole world was back in the Midwest. You know, I was born and raised in Michigan, went to college in Ohio. My husband was born and raised in Indiana, went to college in Ohio. His family's in Indiana, mine's in Michigan. So it was really tough, especially the move to New York, even though we felt like God was leading us in that direction. We went to New York. We didn't really know anybody. We didn't have friends or family. We didn't have a home church. So along the way, I think a lot of relationships were sacrificed. Relationships with friends, relationships with family. You know, I would say, and I write about it in the book, you know, when I got to a certain point where I decided I needed to take a step back, I knew my relationship with God was suffering. So there were a lot of sacrifices for sure.
Well, from the outside looking in, you had the perfect life. You know, if I was watching you and followed your lifeline, I'd be like, wow, she's got this all put together. She's got a family and everything, notable recognition and making a name for who you were, you know, Paula Faris. However, there was a period, a year of hell, as you describe it, where God was knocking down brick walls.
Yeah, you know, here I am at the height of my career. I get called to the network, to ABC back in 2011, and I rise the ranks pretty quickly. Before you know it, I'm the weekend anchor of Good Morning America, and I'm filling in during the week on Good Morning America. I'm asked to co-host The View. I'm at this professional high, but I looked around me and I was at a personal low. Like, my landscape around me was just on fire. My relationships were suffering with my husband and my kids. I wasn't attending church as much as I wanted to. My relationship with God was really lagging. My health took a big hit as well. And so here's this professional high and personal low. And I knew that my professed values were totally clashing with my personal and professional choices. And I remember saying, God, you called me to this, right? Didn't you call me to do this with my life? If so, why is everybody getting my leftovers? It shouldn't be like this. Like, why is my relationship with you suffering? And I knew God was at that moment, God was really trying to get my attention to slow down. But I was so scared. I was scared of failure, scared of what people would think of me if I stepped away from these two prestigious jobs. People would think I was crazy. I thought it was crazy. And so I pressed into it. I continued to press into these jobs. And then it was through a personal crisis that God really got my attention through that season of hell that you mentioned. And within 7 months, I experienced 5 major events. It started with a miscarriage and an emergency surgery, and then a concussion. I was getting ready to go live for Good Morning America, and somebody threw an object at my head, 60 miles an hour, concussed for 3 weeks. And the day I got cleared to go back to work after the concussion, I got in a head-on car crash. And then I get influenza, which turned into pneumonia. And I said, all right, God, I know you want me to slow down. I know you're asking me to obey. I know you're asking me to take that step, even though I can't see the staircase. I don't know what you're asking me to walk into, but you're asking me to be obedient. And I know you're trying to get me to slow down. And so I did. I stepped away. And then in that ensuing space, that's where I write much of the book. I didn't live happily ever after. I discovered after I walked away that I didn't know who I was outside of my job, that my identity and my significance and my purpose was completely wrapped up in work and doing and career and calling. And that's what much of the book is about, is my story and the story of others. I conduct a lot of interviews throughout the book, and I gather anecdotes of others and observations of people who've fallen flat on their face and misplaced their significance and misplaced their purpose and their identity. And then how to discover what unshakable, unrootable, unmovable purpose and true calling looks like. True calling and purpose that don't move in a pandemic. True calling and purpose that don't shake in a personal crisis. So that's what the book's about.
Wow. Well, you mentioned the word calling, and there's lots of buzzwords out there. Calling is one of them, especially as believers, those who, you know, you grow up with that, assuming that you went to church at a younger age, you hear the word calling. How has that word, that meaning shifted for you way back when you were a little girl, knowing and hearing about calling versus now, how do you define your true calling?
Yeah. Well, I think it's one of those words that we throw around very casually in the faith circles, and it's almost always baked into career. It's synonymous with doing. It's synonymous with work. And I think, you know, I don't fault churches. I don't fault anybody. And I don't even, like, for myself, I was just doing what society told me to do, to lean, which is to lean in. And that's almost always career. And I was doing what church told me to do to find my God-given calling, which is always career related. It's always doing related. And so I misplaced my significance based upon that. And that's something that I think we all do. Like, we're told that our worth is work and our value is vocation. Okay. And then in that space where, when I stepped away, I said, okay, God, didn't you call me to do this? God really revealed to me that, we have two callings on our life, and we need to be able to separate those two and see them for what they are and see them in the season. For me, you have a faith calling, which is your purpose, and you have a vocational calling. And your faith calling, or your purpose, is basically your life statement. It's why you're here on this earth. It's who you are, and it's never going to change, not in a personal crisis, not in a pandemic. And it has nothing to do with doing. It has nothing to do with career. So for me, my faith calling, which will never change, is to love God and love people. That's why I'm here. It's not to be the greatest broadcaster. It's not to be anything else than to love God and love people. Now, your vocational calling is what you do, and your vocational calling can shift, and it will shift. God will allow you to branch out. Vocational calling is, for me, God was saying, vocation is just the vehicle. It's just the conduit by which you'll love God and love people, by which you'll fulfill your purpose or your faith calling. And Paula, it's going to change. I'm going to tell you, first of all, Paula, that, you know, I felt God saying this, your worth isn't your work. Don't get too attached to doing. I want you to remember what you're doing and who you're doing it for. Wherever I place you, doesn't matter where it is, it might be seasonal, you're there to show people the love of God. And for me, that was like a really, I really felt God revealing this to me, and it just kind of made sense, but I needed to be able to separate the two. And I think that's something that I had never really heard from the pulpit. And so often, like, when we talk about purpose or we talk about calling, it's always baked into career. And so if we buy that, then guess what? Anytime we experience a vocational shift, which God knows you're going to experience vocational shifts throughout your life, Christy, and I have. Anytime we experience a vocational shift, we're going to experience this shift in who we are, and we're going to have an identity crisis, because so much of our identity and our purpose is baked into doing and not who we are, and not settling into that space of knowing, this is who I am. God created me to love God, love people, full stop, end of story. However he wants me to exercise that through whatever vocation, at whatever season in my life, on whatever branch, that's what I'm there to uniquely use that to love God and love people, that particular branch that I'm on.
Oh, such great wisdom. You all are going to want to pick up your own copy of Called Out, Why I Traded Two Dream Jobs for a Life of True Calling. It is an incredible book, Paula. I mean, oh my gosh, the stories
that you
share in here, the interviews. I mean, we got an international spy. We've got some basketball. We've got some politics stuff wrapped up in here. Anybody's taste, man or woman. Oh, this is a great read. And one that I think the way you lay it out, I love, because you can actually go to a chapter if you want to just dig into that kind of meat. If you're like feeling, I'm kind of stuck here. I don't know where I am vocationally. I'm hooked to it, but I want to find my true calling. I want to be able to open up. So I would encourage people to pick up their own copy. In your year of hell, coming out of this, you set up a meeting with a very prestigious, important man in your life, and it wasn't your husband.
Yeah.
It was James Goldston. What did you discover in that meeting?
Well, this is where the book opens, and I've come out of this year of hell, and I've made the decision to walk away from my two dream jobs. My contract is up at ABC, and James Goldston is my boss. He's the president of ABC News, and I'm telling him that I'm going to walk away from these two jobs, and that I would like to stay at ABC. I'm not sure, like, in what capacity. I think I want to work Monday through Friday, but I just need to get my life back, and I want to launch a faith podcast. Because I really felt like God put it on my heart to launch a faith podcast, something where my faith calling and my vocational calling could kind of like intersect. And I was really, really nervous about the meeting. He was extremely supportive, and I don't think he knew the extent of everything that had happened in my life. But Yeah, I'm grateful for his support. And I left that meeting thinking, did I just like ruin my life? You know, did I just kill my career? But I felt like God had asked me to be obedient. He called me out of the space where I was addicted to work. And I think so often when God tests us, you know, he can allow a personal crisis or a global crisis, you know, he's asking us to be obedient. And I go back to Joshua 1, where Joshua's called to take Jericho down, but he's also, before he does it, he has to just circle, and he has to circle. I don't know why he has to circle seven times, but he does. And I feel like so often when God's asking us to take that leap of faith and to press past the fear, we have to be obedient to that still small voice that we're feeling, obedient to knowing where God is leading us. And we have to press past the fear. Whenever you're making a decision, for me, fear has just plagued me my whole life. I was paralyzed to step away from my two dream jobs, scared, fearful of what I was stepping away from and fearful of what I was stepping into. But, you know, God has commanded us to press into that fear. In Joshua 1, it says, have I not commanded us to be strong and courageous? Don't be afraid, don't be discouraged, for the Lord your God's with you everywhere you go. And so for me, that verse has really been such a big promise on my life, that when God asks us to do something, he's going to equip us. In the same way he was with Moses, he'll be with us. But we are commanded to take that first step, to step out in faith, to press past the fear. God acknowledges it's going to be present, but he also promises that he's going to be there in it, through it, past it, with us the entire time.
Amen. What an incredible example of cultivating a desire bigger than fear. You have done that in your life through small changes. For the ones who are listening, how can people begin to overcome fear that may be holding them back?
Well, I think you have to anticipate it and you have to expect it. Fear isn't something that we conquer and never have to deal with again. And I just remember that fear is of the devil, right? Fear is not from God. So yeah. I think anticipate it and expect it. And then remember that verse, like when God calls you, he's going to equip you in the same way he's with Moses, he'll be with you. God's commanded us to press past it, to press into it. And then he's promised that he's going to be there on the other side. Faith's taking that first step when you can't see the staircase. And that's what so many times God is asking us to do. He's just asking us to be obedient, to press into the fear, and he's going to be there. He's going to meet us on the other side. He's going to meet us in it. So, but it's up to us whether we want to take that first step.
Yeah, he's willing to go into battle with us, but you're right. We have to take that one step at a time to lead to miles of greatness.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, I keep hearing people keep asking me, like, how do I know that God's calling me into a different season? Like, I know for me, God was trying to get my attention. I took a snapshot of my landscape, my relationships, my health, like everything was falling apart around me and my values were clashing with my choices and everybody was getting my leftovers. And I felt that stirring. I think the Lord can speak to you, you know, in your gut. I felt that there was a stirring. I didn't have a peace about where I was in my life, even though I was at this career high. And God, you know, once I decided to step away, God really spoke to me. I had to know where to listen to him, because it's easy to listen to the wrong voices. You know, God can speak to you through sermons and through scriptures. He's never parted the skies and spoken a baritone voice to me, but he definitely has spoken through songs. You know, when you're in the car and that song that's played 1,000 times before all of a sudden speaks to you in that moment, that's God speaking to you. He speaks to you through podcasts. He speaks to you through books. He speaks to you through trusted people in your life. And if you don't have people in your life that know what the undercarriage looks like, that knows what it looks like under the hood, that can call you out on the good, bad, and the ugly, then you need a strong circle of friends, because God can speak to you through those people. So for me, just learning to know where to listen to God, and also accepting that God can speak to us in this myriad of capacities and speak to us through dreams. God has spoken to me through even sometimes the most unlikely of people. So I think, you know, when something's off in your spirit, and then just know where to listen to God.
So good. Called out, a book you're going to want to pick up, Why I Traded Two Dream Jobs for a Life of True Calling. Well, in your book, I got to say, there were some times I was like on pins and needles going, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? And then there was this one that just got me and I was bawling. I was crying. And you are just so close to your dad.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And he passed before this book was finished.
Mm-hmm.
There were some journals and writings that you found of his.
Yeah.
What was one entry that you read that spoke to your heart the most?
Well, my dad, he passed away in February of 2019 as I was writing the book. And my dad, in his passing, gave me and my siblings the gift of perspective and the gift of knowing what's consequential and what's not. And we're going through a lot of his belongings, and I discover this box of all kinds of papers. My dad was an engineer, so a lot of content, but not necessarily a lot of organization. And there were these journals that my mom didn't even know existed. And one particular journal, I mean, my dad was talking about being the black sheep in his family and, you know, trying to find his peace in things like, you know, booze and women and staying out late, but he could never find this peace. And I just got a snapshot into, you know, the insecurities that had plagued my father growing up and some of his own struggles. He was a wonderful human being, but he had his own issues like we all do. And it gave me a real good sense of, you know, the dad that I knew, that I was the family I was born into, my dad was a believer. But, you know, the first 40 years of my father's life, he was really searching, and he was searching for peace and from, you know, transcendental meditation, Valium. Like, he was looking to find peace in any way that he could. And it wasn't until he started attending a charismatic Christian community that he had been invited to, where he really felt the peace of the Lord. And it was in that moment that he, like, decided that he was, he was the definition of someone that knew the difference between faith calling and vocational calling. He knew that his worth wasn't work. And he was a brilliant man. He was an engineer. He had multiple opportunities to move up the corporate ladder, but wanted to be home. In his death and, you know, the months that led up to it, he was surrounded by this, you know, the people that he had invested, the people that he had loved. That investment into his purpose and his faith calling, people were by his side every single day, to the point where the facilities where he was at were like, this is like, people don't get this amount of visitors, but it's because my dad had sown so much into people and relationships. And he knew that what he did was just an extension of who he was. And the last conversation that I had with my father, you know, he had been surrounded by family and friends and he was ready to go. He couldn't speak or swallow or eat or drink because he had had a massive stroke. So I had to ask him closed-ended questions. And he was really in a lot of pain because his body was shutting down. He lost 60 pounds from August to February of 2019. And I said, he was crying. And this was the Saturday before he passed away. And I said, Dad, are you crying because you're sad? And he said, no. He shook his head no. I said, Daddy, are you crying because you're in pain? He shook his head no. And I said, Daddy, are you crying because you're overwhelmed by the love and the memories and the people? And he nodded yes. And really, that's the last exchange that I had with my dad. And I'll never forget that. That's motivated me to be a better person. That's motivated me to find my true calling. And I write the book and I dedicate it to my dad. And you know, I said, Dad, I love you forever and I'll see you again. And I live knowing that that day will come and I will see my father again. But I thank my dad for being an example of someone who really pressed into his purpose and knew who he was outside of what he did.
Well, it's a beautiful story. And you all are going to have to pick up your own copy to read all of it. Paula, I lost my father at the age of 65. He died way too soon. So it's probably why it's very touching to me. And I'm telling you, there's nothing more precious than a daughter and a father relationship.
It's beautiful.
And I read it in your book and I can feel it in your heart. And I know right now that your dad is looking down going, way to go, girl. I'm celebrating with you. Paula, of 20 questions, right?
Yeah, I know. I was like, Dad, I told you I'd do something with my incessant questioning. So my dad was just like, he just, I always tried to shock him, but we had such, I'm the youngest of four children. So my siblings joke that I got away with everything. I said, no, I was just persistent. And I just wore my father down until he said, yes. He's like, fine, just leave me alone and stop asking. It's that, tenacity. So
yes. Well, it's a beautiful thing. Well, knowing what you know today, Paula, what would you tell your younger self that would help moms and dads?
What I would tell my younger self is, to give yourself lots of grace. I've learned more through my failures than I have in my successes. But what I would tell my younger self is that to remember what you're doing and who you're doing it for, that your worth isn't your work, and your value is not your vocation, and your calling isn't your career. You are so much more than what you do. And God has given you the permission. Once you accept that your worth isn't your work, God gives you the permission to branch out and to try new things and to realize that vocation can be seasonal. We shouldn't back ourselves into a corner and think I have to do this the rest of my life. God can use you in a myriad of capacities based upon the unique talents and gifts that he's given you. So not only is it seasonal, not only can you branch out and try new things, but I think there's this lie that so many women buy from society that we can't off-ramp if we want and stay home with our kids for a little bit because we'll never get back in. And if we do off-ramp, well, that's not valuable. I mean, stay-at-home momming is a vocational calling, and that can be seasonal too. So just accept the different seasons on your life, the different branches that God has called you to, but all staying rooted in knowing that your worth is not your work.
Amen. Amen. So good. And you write in your book too about the vine and the branches. We're not going to go into it. I want people to pick up their copy because I think if we understand how grapes grow, how vines grow, how they have to be rooted within, it's a beautiful, beautiful thing. So I would really encourage you all to pick up your own copy. Well, as you talk about change, right, you want to make a difference in your own life, but it doesn't happen overnight. How did you begin to make those small incremental changes for a greater impact?
Well, I had to, accept that worth wasn't work. And that gave me the permission to see myself as more than what I did. And once I did that, once I accepted that this vocational branch that I'm on right now is where God has me, but I think there are other things that he's placed on my heart to give myself the permission to go there and to not see myself so one-dimensionally. But to just see vocational calling for what it is and to see those vocational branches for what they are. And just for me, it was a paradigm shift, instead of like doing and chasing things for the wrong reasons, spotlight, accolade, accomplishment, achievement. I remember what I'm doing and who I'm doing it for. And my identity is rooted in who I am to love God and love people. It's not rooted in what I'm doing. And just for me, just that paradigm shift of accepting vocation as the vehicle, vocation is the conduit by which I'm going to love God and love people. And remember, just remembering at all times what I'm doing and who I am doing it for. It's not about me. It's not about me. It's easy and it can become about us. But once we realize and have that small paradigm shift, I mean, it's made the world of difference for me.
Oh, beautiful. Well, knowing what you know now, if you had to write your headline for the evening news for Paula Faris, what would it read?
Gosh, I don't know. That is so difficult. I love the first line of my book. There's no rational way to kill your career. I mean, I think headline, you don't want to give away too much with a headline, but you want to tease people. Maybe I would say career killer, question mark. So I don't know. Or I would say something, your worth isn't your work. My worth wasn't my work. So something along those lines.
I love it. Well, I had to have a journalist question in here.
Something
fun, a little bit lighter. Well, you have a brand new podcast, Journeys of Faith, and it really allowed you to have your vocational and your faith calling intersect. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. So when I was in that space and having this meeting with my boss, he said, well, what do you want to do? And I said, I need to get my life back. I can't keep working these crazy hours. And I said, I'd like to launch a faith podcast where I talk to newsmakers and influencers of many different faiths about what they believe and why, because I know my faith has been so instrumental in my life and it's been the glue that's held me together when I felt like I was going to fall apart. And so I launched Journeys of Faith. We've done 3 seasons and I just get a chance to talk to people about, you know, what they believe and why and how it gets them through the ups and downs of life. And it's a chance to see these people in a totally different light and to show them the love of Jesus. I'm not speaking to just my echo chamber. I'm not speaking to just Christians. I'm speaking to people of many different faiths. And so it's an opportunity, again, for me to sit down and have a respectful conversation. Yeah, I don't necessarily agree with everything they believe, but I at least want to listen and I want to love and respect them. And I think, you know, in this moment, we don't want to sit down with people that don't think like us, don't act like us, don't speak like us. But it's enough for me to love these people and to respect them because they're made in God's image. And I think just sitting down and having a respectful conversation, you can, you know, respectfully disagree. You can disagree without being disagreeable and show them that there's a difference in you. And we don't have to see eye to eye, but at the end of the day, I can respect you and I can love you because you are a child of God. It's been a really great format, different than TV, the world of podcasting, and I'm grateful for it, but it's also seasonal. I don't know how long that's going to last. And I have to like not get so attached to the doing and not so attached to that particular branch that I'm on, knowing that God might move in a different direction.
Well, I know he's got big plans for your life. He already wrote a book. Now you got the podcast over here. I know people are going to want to connect with you. Besides the book and the podcast, where can they find you?
The best way that you can connect with me is through Instagram or Twitter. I do post occasionally on Facebook, but I don't really check messages. I'm not social media savvy, and I don't have kids that can help me with it yet. So, but if you reach out to either Twitter or Instagram, my handle is Paula Faris. It's the same for both Twitter and Instagram, my first name and last name. Faris is spelled just like Paris, the city, but with an F like Frank. So I'm usually pretty good about responding. And I'm just grateful that people are picking up the book and that they're supporting this. I never thought I'd write a book. The joke is I'm an open book. I never thought I'd write one. But I really feel that God gave me a message. I didn't want to write a book just to write a book. And so, but I feel like God gave me this message and I want to share it with people. And I want to encourage them and inspire them and equip them how they can really root into this unshakable purpose in their life that doesn't shift during a pandemic, doesn't shift during a personal crisis.
Before I let you go, we could be here forever, and I want to extend an invitation. You are welcome back. We would love to have you back. But the series is called My Strength is My Story. Mm-hmm. What has your story gifted you?
My story has gifted me with grace. Because I have failed more times than I can count, but I feel like in those failures, God has allowed me to not only give myself grace, but give other people grace. And I've learned more through my own failures and shortcomings than I have from my successes. And I just think we've been given grace so undeservedly, we need to dole it out to others and to ourselves.
Well, Paula, you are a beautiful diamond in the rough, and I can't wait to see how God continues to shine you up. You're called out, girl. Go out and have a beautiful day. Love your story.
Thank you, Christine. Thanks, everybody, for listening and for supporting the book. I really appreciate it.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.